Python's decorators seem like magic until they turn your code into a nightmare. They look like a clean, even fun way to add functionality, but they come with some hidden pitfalls that can make debugging harder, break type safety, and create unexpected issues. Now, before we get into why I think you should mostly avoid them, let's first break down what decorators are and how they actually work. Let's jump in. So what is a decorator in Python? It's a function that takes another function as input and modifies or extends its behavior. And this is actually done without changing the original function's code, which makes decorators a form of metaprogramming. Now, Python introduced decorators way back in version 2.4 in 2004, and they have been widely used ever since. One of the most useful built-in decorators is data class, which automatically generates special methods for a class. So you've surely seen and used data classes before if you've been using Python for a while. But basically how that's done is you import from data classes the data classes decorator. And then what you can do is use the data class decorator on a class. And in this case, you can simply define some fields like name, age, etc., etc. Now, this is not the normal syntax for adding members to the class. You should normally do that in an initializer, but with data class, this is a much simpler way of doing it. And also, it generates other methods like wrapper, for example. So if I have my main function, I can now create a person like so, and then I can simply print that. And then when I do uv run main.py, then basically it's going to print that person. This is an example of a good use case for decorators. It saves boilerplate code, it doesn't introduce weird side effects. Now, next to using these types of built-in decorators, you can also create decorators yourself. Let's, for example, create a simple logging decorator that prints a message before calling a function. What you need to do then in Python is create a function wrapper. So let's say I have a log function wrapper that gets another function as an argument. That's the function that it wraps around. And then within that, we have a wrapper. You see that my AI actually already generates that for me. So I have my wrapper function here. The only thing that this does, it simply prints that this function is being called with certain arguments and keyword arguments, and then it returns calling that function. So the only thing it does is wrap around that function. And then the result of that is that we return that function. And then the only thing that the decorator syntax in Python actually does is call this function that is getting returned here. So how do you use this then? Well, you could create a log function decorator call, and then I'm simply going to do that on top of another function. In this case, I'm adding A and B. And then let's see what happens if we're going to print adding 1 and 2. I'll remove this part because that's not really relevant at the moment. Let me run this script again. And now you see that it calls this logging function because we added the decorator on top of it. Again, this is a pretty good use case of a situation where you could use a decorator. There's a problem though in the current implementation, which is that the function name and the docstring of the add function are now actually wrong. So if I print add.dunderName like so, so you would expect that to be the name of the function. So let's see what happens if we do that. So you see that actually now that is called wrapper. And why is that? Well, that's because that is actually the function that we return here. Now you might say, well, who cares, right? Because I never actually use this value. But, you know, it is kind of dangerous if that's not correct, because in other places in your code, it might be used. It may be used when you automatically generate documentation or whatever. So you really want to make sure that this is neat and as expected. Now, this is actually a pretty easy fix. What you can do, there is a wraps function in functools. So I can import functools, and then I can write another decorator, functools.wraps, and then it wraps around that function like so. And that's the only thing you need to do to fix this, because when I run this again, now you see that actually the function name is correct. In short, if you write your own decorators, make sure you also do this so that it works as expected in all situations. Another thing you might want to do is make sure that you add proper type annotations. You see that my type checker already complains about this. So let's just use AI to add these annotations. And there we go. And now we have a nice little decorator with annotations. Great, this AI stuff. I don't even have to use my brains anymore. Now, knowing how these decorators work is great, but understanding how to design software from scratch is even more important. I've put together a free design guide that walks you through the 7 key steps I use when designing software. It covers everything from structuring your code to avoiding common pitfalls, things I wish I had known earlier. Get your free copy at ArjanCodes/design guide. Link is also in the description. Now that we know how decorators work, let's look at why they can actually be harmful. The first problem is that the order of decorators can actually cause some unexpected bugs. Many web apps use authentication, caching, and other things for faster responses. But if you use decorators for that and you stack them in the wrong order, then you can actually break your app. Here's an example of what that could look like. So I have an authenticate decorator that actually does user authentication before calling a function. And then I have another function here that fetches a user from a database. Not for real, it's just for showing you this, but this function could potentially connect with the database and retrieve the data. So you might also want to cache that, right? So I've added this so that if you call it twice, it actually does the database request only once. And then I have a main function where I call that function a couple of times. The issue here is that authenticate is run before the caching. So it's now also cached, and you can actually see that happening. If I do uv run deck order.pi, then you see that I'm authenticating the user and then I fetch it from the database. But the second time that I fetch it, actually this is now cached, so the user is no longer authenticated. And that's because in Python, decorators are evaluated from bottom to top, because each decorator wraps around the one below it. So in that case, that means that this thing is going to cache whatever comes out of this thing. So that means that it will also cache authentication. However, that is typically the case, not even 100% sure that this is what's going to happen, because the decorator can also decide to run code after calling the function. For example, here, I'm running this code before actually calling the function, but I could, in theory, do something like this. So I can print something else, and then I'm going to return the result, like so. So now, when I run this again, you actually see that the user authenticated part is run after we fetch the user from the database. In short, it's not always clear in which order things are going to be run when you're using multiple decorators. Now to fix this, let me actually return just the function result and not do this anymore. To fix this problem, you can swap these things. So we are going to cache the result of fetch user, but then we're going to authenticate on top of that. And now when I run this again, you see that we're authenticating the user every time I'm retrieving something from the database. And caching actually still works properly. So it only retrieves the user from the database here and here when we're changing the ID. So that's the first problem. Decorators and functions and how they interact can be confusing. The second problem is that decorators can actually break your code analysis and typing. And for that, I want to show you this example. Some decorators modify function signatures in unexpected ways, which makes it difficult for IDEs and type checkers to understand your code. So here I'm using Hydra. This is a config management library. I talked about it a while back in one of my videos. But basically how it works is that you add a decorator, hydra.main, and that gets some information like where is the config file. So I'm reading a config YAML file here, and then it injects an argument into that function. So in that case, this is the config. Let's actually run this to see what happens, like so. So as you can see, it reads some configuration settings from a config file. Doesn't really matter what it does. Now you might say, oh, that's actually nice. So I can just use this decorator and then I'm just going to get an argument that then contains the values that I need. In principle, sounds like a great design, right? But the problem here is that it introduces something weird in your code, namely that we have this function here that I need to call without arguments. And then Hydra is going to inject that argument for me. So you might run into all sorts of issues where your type system might complain that it's expecting an argument here, but it didn't get one. It's just very confusing. And that also makes it hard to debug because you're calling a function differently than what you would expect if you just take a look at the signature. A much better solution here, in my opinion, is to not use decorators at all, but simply have a function that reads the config. Then when you need to read a config value, You call that function. Simple as that. And if you're worried about performance, you could even add caching so it only reads the config files once. Honestly, it doesn't have to be more complicated than that. I think using a decorator in this way is overkill and it has more disadvantages than actual advantages. So I would recommend against this. Now, third problem that's actually kind of related to this is that a decorator can introduce hidden function requirements. Some decorators expect specific arguments in your function, even if you don't actually use them. A great example is if you're using FastAPI with the slow API rate limiting decorator. Here's an example of that. So I use FastAPI and slow API, which is the rate limiter you can use for FastAPI. So I create instances of these things right here. And then I have a route that is limited by 2 requests per second. And I use these 2 decorators here. So I have the limiter decorator, and I have my app decorator that's generated by FastAPI. So purely by looking at this, you would expect, well, this would work perfectly fine, right? We just add this simple decorator right here. However, if I run this code, you'll see that this actually crashes because actually this limiter expects that there is a request object. So the way to fix this in this particular case is that we are supposed to add a request object, which is of type request from FastAPI, like so. And now when I run this again, it works without any issue. But here's the problem. Request is actually not being used in the function. You even see that my type checker gives me a warning like, hey, this is not accessed. So you might think, okay, maybe I can then replace this by an underscore, which is the standard way in Python of indicating that you still need an argument, but you're not going to use it. But then actually it crashes again because it actually wants a request argument. So that means that if we're using it in this way, we are required to have a warning in our type system just to use rate limiting. I think that's a really bad design decision, and it's one of the issues that decorators can introduce. Now, to solve this particular issue, I think, honestly, it makes way more sense that limiting is built directly into FastAPI, since it's so directly coupled to it. Now, of course, that's not the reality. We live in reality, so I have to deal with it, right? But if I were to write a rate limiting library, I would probably write something that extends the FastAPI decorator with rate limiting. So I would basically create a new version of this that behaves exactly like the FastAPI decorator, but then you can use that instead of the one from FastAPI. And this means you don't have to use an extra decorator with all of the issues that it introduced, and you can keep it simple. And then if my hypothetical library works well, maybe Sebastian is going to incorporate it into the FastAPI package in the future. Who knows? By the way, if this video saved you from an unexpected decorator-induced headache, hit the like button. It helps me more than you think. And if you enjoy deep dives into Python and software design like this video, subscribe so you don't miss the next video. So we've seen problems with the order of decorators, with decorators introducing arguments to functions that are not there, decorators that expect arguments to be there, even though it doesn't make sense from a typing perspective. And on top of that, you're going to run into other issues as well if you use decorators a lot in your code. One is harder debugging. When something goes wrong in a decorated function, you often see errors inside the decorator, not where the actual problem is. So stack traces become harder to read, debugging takes longer. And second, you're going to also have to deal with unit tests that are going to be harder to write because you might need to mock or patch decorators to test your functions, which add unnecessary complexity. And finally, since decorators wrap functions, that adds an extra layer of execution. And if they do some expensive operations that you don't clearly see by just putting the decorator on top, this can actually considerably slow down performance of your code. So overall, in my opinion, Python's decorators look elegant, but they also introduce a lot of hidden complexity, and it's really easy to make bad software design decisions. They do have some valid use cases. Think of the data class decorator or basic things like a property or a static method decorator. In most cases, they actually make your code harder to read and maintain. And my recommendation is to avoid them if you can. But I'm curious what you think about this. Have you used decorators a lot? Do you regularly build your own decorators? What are the kind of issues that you encounter while doing that? Let me know in the comments. If you want to learn other ways to help you become really good at Python, make sure you check out this video next. Thanks for watching and see you next time.